get down to the nitty-gritty of the basics?
Let's go.
Ready.
Let's meet our guest. Today on the show, we have the author of The Knitter's Companion, a book that I would never leave home without, Vicki Square. So nice to see you. Thank you for coming.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Tell me, how did you get started knitting?
My grandma taught me. I was a little girl. You could find me on the playground playing ball, or you might find me over by the side of the school building casting on.
So that's fantastic.
There's a picture for you.
I love that.
Yeah.
So why don't you explain to someone that's never come into a knitting store and they want to get started, where you go?
Well, as you can see, yarn, needles, notions.
Okay.
The yarns bring us in there, and there's just a real variety of textures and types and colors, obviously. Mm-hmm. These illustrate that there are various weights of yarn, from very fine to very bulky. This middle one here would be what you'd consider your garden variety worsted weight, and that's a term you'll hear an awful lot, and that's just kind of a basic yarn.
All right. And then for a beginner, what do you recommend the weight-wise, what they look for?
A worsted, somewhere between a worsted and a bulky, anything in there, and I would recommend then a needle size appropriate to that.
Okay, and where do they find their needle size?
On the label, actually.
Okay. Let's take a look at these labels. They can be a little confusing.
On this label, there's all these hieroglyphics that tell you what you can do, how to care for your yarn, whether you can wash it by hand or machine, whether you can dry clean it, whether you can iron it.
And then the most important one?
The needle recommendation. And it truly is a recommendation. You can choose to make your garment a little tighter and more jacket-like, or you can make it loose and drapey depending on the needle size.
Okay, so we go over to the needles.
Needles come in a range of different types. What they're made from, they can be plastic, wood, bamboo, metal. They can be straight, as you can see all these. They can be double pointed, which means you can have options like knitting in the round, like this right here, like for a pair of socks.
Right.
You can have metal needles, and you can have them straight or circular. And circular needles, you can knit in the round, just like on these small double pointed needles, but you can also knit back and forth. And what a circular needle will do for you is accommodate a lot of stitches for a really large project.
Right, and kind of take the weight off your wrists or whatever.
Yep.
Great. Okay. So I noticed that the yarns are coming in all different forms.
Yes,
they
are.
Why don't we go over when we need to wind, how we'd go about doing that?
Sure. This is a hank. It looks like a rope or a figure eight. This would be a ball, and this would be a skein. From a skein, you can already pull out the center and start right away. A ball may need to be rewound. A hank definitely does.
Okay, so we need to hand wind.
It comes like this.
Okay.
You can either put it on the swift and wind it with a ball winder, but if you don't have that equipment, then you do the buddy system.
Okay, so I'll just grab this here.
You grab that. I'm going to start winding. You take the end of the yarn in your hand. You wind around two fingers while you're holding.
You gotta do a little, little jig over
Little dance, little dance. Once you've got a wad in your hand, remove your fingers, place your thumb in the center of that, and wind perpendicular to your first wind. Continue to rotate around this little wad that you started with.
Okay. And there you've got your ball.
Yeah. You end up with something like this.
Okay.
And at the very end, you wind sideways.
And
you
secure.
Tuck the end in.
And so the only notions that we need to get started really that are important are really these three things,
right? Just the tapestry needle for weaving in ends, a tape measure, and a pair of scissors.
Okay, great.
All the other notions are for fun.
Okay, so this is everything to get started knitting, right?
Mm-hmm. You've got it.
Okay, before we get started though, let's take a look at this knit bit.
Did you know that between 1998 and 2002, there was a 400% increase in the number of women under the age of 35 who knit?
Hi, and welcome back to Nitty Gritty. I'm here with knitting guru, Vicki Square. Okay, so we've picked our yarn, we have our needles. What's our first step?
Well, you've got to get this yarn on the needles so that you can learn to knit. So the first thing that we're going to do is called casting on.
Okay, let's use the knitting cam for that so they can really see.
The great thing about using the knitting cam is that we get to see the project from the knitter's perspective.
If you will take a length of yarn and leave a tail about 18 inches long for this practice, wrap the yarn around your two fingers, then spread your two fingers apart a bit, push the yarn in from the back and pull it through that loop and adjust down. It's an adjustable loop. You place it on your needle and pull it down until it's snug against the needle, but you can still move it up and down the needle. That's your slip knot and also counts as your first stitch.
All right.
The tail is hanging down. The working yarn is what's attached to the ball. The working yarn goes over your index finger. Mm-hmm. The tail goes over your thumb.
Yes.
Hold the remainder of the yarns in the palm of your hand with your other fingers. Then make sure that the needle and your hand both point up so that you can see that there's a yarn at the front of your thumb. This is called the long tail method of cast on, and I find it to be pretty universal and a real elastic method and stable cast on for beginners to use.
I love that you're showing this because I actually don't cast on this way, so this is
okay.
Great.
So you've got the tail, you've got the working yarn, you've got an empty needle with slip knot on your right needle in your right hand. Go under the yarn at the front of your thumb, around the yarn on your index finger, back down through the space of the thumb, release the thumb yarn, and adjust by simply bringing your thumb back under that tail yarn.
Oh, that's great. That gives you a lot of control.
Up under the thumb, around the index, back down through the space, release and adjust.
Okay.
Always move your hands back to what seems like a vertical position so that you can see that yarn on the front of your thumb.
Okay, and if you're not getting all this, please don't worry. Don't go to DIYnetwork.com and the information will be there. Okay, Vicki, what's next? Are we ready to knit?
We are.
Okay.
Once the stitches are on the needle, you then place the needle in your left hand. You now ignore the tail because it won't matter till you're done with your project. Bring the working yarn under the needle, over your index finger, and in the palm of your hand against the needle for tension.
Okay.
I am showing you the continental method of knitting so that the working yarn is in your left hand.
Okay.
That method of knitting is primarily focused on a needle movement. So I will enter the first stitch with my empty right needle front to back, dip that needle around, mm-hmm. and leverage it back through that stitch to the front and off the end.
Okay.
Okay, into that stitch front to back, dip around the yarn that goes over your index finger, leverage it back through that space to the front and off the end.
And is this the method you actually prefer using?
I prefer this because it's faster. I find that I can keep my tension more even, and I like knitting more than one garment per season.
All right, now. Step back now.
Okay, when I teach kids, this is how I teach them to do it, and I know this is a funny little poem, but
okay.
It makes you remember.
All right.
In through the front door, around through the back, peek out the window, and out jumps Jack.
Oh, that's cute. Aww, that's
you'll
so
remember,
sweet.
Even.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, in through the front door, around through the back, peek out the window,
and
off jumps
there
Jack.
Comes Jack.
Yeah, there
All
you
right.
go. Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to show you the throwing method of knitting, which accomplishes the same thing, but now the working yarn is in your right hand.
Okay.
So to achieve tension, you may have to wrap it around your little finger and then over your index finger. The right needle goes into the stitch exactly the same way, but then you actually let go of your right needle, wrap your yarn around, leverage it through to the front, and off. So it's the same movement, but you're doing it with your right hand.
And if you've learned either method, please don't feel like one is better than the other. This is really just a matter of preference.
It is a matter of preference. I learned the throw method when I was a little girl, and I switched over to continental method when I was, I don't know, a teenager. And so you can do whichever you prefer.
I actually tried to do the same thing because I wanted to be speedier. And for a while, I just didn't dig on the purling with the left hand. So for a while, I knit continental, and I purled. With the throw method, which is great, except for my whole row gauge was off, so I kind of abandoned it. Okay, so how many do you need to cast on?
Well, that's a discussion for gauge.
Let's say we want a scarf that's four inches.
If we're just going to make a scarf,
yeah.
And you're making it, well, that'll depend on the yarn also. I mean, look at the two different sizes here.
Right.
If you're working with the super bulky and you want a 4-inch scarf, you might end up with 8 or 10 stitches is all. With this one, you might end up between 16 and 20 stitches.
Okay, so you need to check out your gauge, and then you'll figure out inch-wise how wide you want your scarf. If you've made mistakes, please don't worry about it. We're going to get to that next.
Are you a southpaw yearning to learn to knit? Studies show that left-handed knitters often pick up the continental method, a little easier than the throw method of knitting, because the work in knitting, the basic stitch is called the knit stitch. When working every row in knit stitch, you create what's called garter stitch. The garter stitch creates a fabric that looks the same on both sides and stretches more lengthwise than crosswise.
Welcome back to Nitty Gritty. I'm Vicki Howell here with Vicki Square. So I know that you teach knitting. What's the thing that you find the most frustrating for beginners?
Well, a couple of things. One of which, let me point out these gauge samples. Knitters like to blow by step one because they just want to get right on with it. And this is critical. Same yarn, same 20 stitches on each sample, different needle sizes. This is a 10.5, bit of a larger needle, 6 inches wide. Size 9 needle, just a bit smaller, 5 inches wide. Size 7 needle, 4.5 inches wide. So the same number of stitches is 3 different sizes. So if they want their garment or their whatever their project is to come out a certain size, they must pay attention to gauge.
Okay, so we were talking about before your first project, maybe it wouldn't matter as much if you were just doing a scarf, but for a sweater, this is a crucial step, people. You've got to do this. All right, we've began knitting and we find a mistake. What now?
That's the next point. Beginners, I find, oftentimes create stitches where there weren't any and lose them where there were. So they might have a pole or draw stitches off and it runs down. And if you don't catch it, it's going to run all the way down to the bottom, just like the run in your stockings. What I encourage beginners to do is to actually remove the knitting from the needles.
This terrifies a lot of beginners.
This is very scary for beginners. Okay. But they need to ravel down past their mistakes, so go all the way past our hole. Make sure that you stop with the working yarn on the left side. And then what I want beginners to do is release the stitch one at a time and place an empty needle into the stitch from the front side.
Okay, so you're pulling as you go along.
Yes. You pull the working yarn out, you put the needle into the stitch from the front, and that way the stitch goes on the needle correctly. You have to consider a stitch to be an upside down U.
Okay.
When it's in correct position, it's open at the bottom. When it's not in correct position, it might be crossed over and you get a twisted stitch.
Okay, let's show them that.
This is what a twisted stitch would look like.
See
that crossover? You don't want that. You want an open U at the bottom of the stitch. The right-hand side of the stitch goes on the front of the needle as it faces you.
Okay.
And that always happens if you insert the needle in from the front from the left side. I think this helps beginning knitters to visualize the right way so that they can identify most immediately when they do make a mistake and can avoid those holes in the future.
Okay, and if you're missing any of this, please don't worry about it. The exact instructions will be on DIYnetwork.com.
Yeah.
Okay, you fixed your mistake, so you can just continue knitting on like you were before.
Sure.
You're at the end,
and it's
time for the big finish.
Want to finish off.
Okay.
The finish is called bind off. It sometimes may be called cast off, but you'll see bind off.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So again, yarn underneath over your index finger, knit two stitches. When you've got 2 stitches on your right-hand needle, with your left needle, insert the point into the rightmost stitch, lift it up and over off the end of the needle, and you've down to 1. That's a bind off of 1. Knit another one, pass the right stitch off over the left, knit another one, pass the right stitch off over the left, off the end of the needle. You end up with a real clean edge that secures these stitches, tidies them off, they're not going anywhere. In order to bind off, you've got to have 2 stitches on the right needle. The right-hand stitch is lifted and passed over the left-hand stitch and off the end of the needle.
Okay, so what happens when you get to your last stitch?
What happens when you get to the last stitch, you cut the yarn leaving a tail that you are going to work in. There's no knots in knitting, so you're not just going to tie a knot and finish it off that way. You draw the cut end of the yarn through the loop and pull it down tightly, and then you can weave your ends in.
Okay.
And it's done. You've got a nice clean edge.
And you are done with your first project. Check you out. While you've been working away, our knitsters have been doing the same. We're going to check back in with them.